Thank you for your introduction. I would also like to welcome you to this talk. I think I can manage in about 15 minutes now, not as long as it's shown in the program. Let me introduce first of all our institute at DLR. We are an institute working in the field of energy storage. This means we're not only looking at thermal energy storage, which is the subject here of the talk, but also at other options like battery storage or electrolysis, hydrogen storage, compressed air storage, so different technologies. And we also do have a group at our institute looking at energy scenarios. If there are some political targets to increase the renewables to a certain share and you need to calculate what is the best way to achieve this share, then this group can assist in this work and can do energy scenarios for different countries. So if there's any need, I can make a link. Myself, I'm from a group, Thermal Process Technology. We look at thermal energy storage in a wider sense, not only molten salt storage. We have different technologies there. We look at solid media storage. So we have four different groups looking at different technologies. And in my group, I'm looking at molten salt storage, but we have also a group for latent heat storage using phase change materials and also thermochemical heat storage. So these two technologies are commercial and they are still in a development stage. Then we have another group looking at also techno-economic assessment and doing work for all of these groups. Let me quickly introduce the different storage options. So these are all thermal energy storage options at high temperatures. We have a focus on high temperatures. We don't do hot water storage, but do storage systems at a higher temperature levels above 100 degrees. And we can do this in ceramics, for example, with regenerator type storage with gases. We can have pressurized water storage systems in this temperature level. And then another technology is latent heat storage, as mentioned, but this is not fully commercial at high temperatures. And for CSP plants, of course, the option is molten salt, so this has been the successful technology. But other things have been tried in the past, like pressurized water was tried as well, but is in the end too costly. I also added some cost figures. It's a rather costly technology for high capacities, and the temperatures are also very limited. There have been ideas with oil, but this was also not successful in the end, so the solution was molten salt here. I would like to show some international figures. So these are numbers from the International Energy Agency about the installed global capacity for grid-connected storage. So we see one thing, this is very, very dominated by pumped hydro storage, grid-connected storage. And then we see a very small share on top of this, and this is a larger size figure here of this top part. And then we see that there's a growing number in dark blue, and this is thermal energy storage. So installed capacity. It's about 2.5 gigawatt in the world now. These are a bit older numbers. And we find that batteries is rather small. And this is in terms of gigawatt. If we look at gigawatt hours, the difference is much larger. There's much more thermal energy storage. The gap is even much larger. It's about 1 to 30. So this growth is basically due to CSP installations. So there's a large contribution. And if you want to order this, first storage option is pumped hydro with the largest share, then thermal energy storage, and after that, batteries. In the public awareness, batteries are very dominant, but in fact, the numbers show that we have a lot of thermal energy storage installations already. We already saw tower systems in the morning from Rainer Buch. So he explained about this configuration, and the second configuration is for the storage system is the parabolic trough installation. This is a historically older installation where we have the two tanks. It was also mentioned the temperature difference is very small here. We also have temperature gradients and heat exchanger to the oil of the solar field and to the power block, which means if we discharge the systems, we operate only part load of our power block, which is not very nice. And the other thing is the temperature difference is rather small. This means also we have to have a very large system. So the better configuration, if we look from the thermal storage side, is the tower configuration, because we have large temperature difference. We run the power block continuously. It was also shown in the morning. Gemma Solar can produce constant power. This is not feasible here. So from a storage point of view, this configuration is preferred. And of course, the impact of the storage is that we extend the operation hour of the power block. There are longer operation hours. We can reduce the part load here of the power block and deliver dispatchable power to the grid. So this is the benefit in the end of the storage system. This is a quick overview of indirect systems. This is a picture from the Andasol free plant. You can see here a car in comparison. It's about 14 meter high here and 34 meter in diameter. A large amount of molten salt is being used. And this is a typical size, 1000 megawatt hour or 1 gigawatt hour, 8 hours. So there are a lot of installations like this, about 30 worldwide, or there may be more nowadays. If we want to go to larger systems, we see the height is not increasing anymore. This is because there are limitations with the pump. The pump comes from the top. So this is not possible to build higher systems at the moment, and also the diameter is not increased further. What the people did in the US is they built more tanks to allow for more storage capacity. Now the configuration in Crescent Dunes. This is also two tank systems, and it can operate up to 24 hours. And as mentioned, it's a direct system where we have the same medium as heat transfer fluid and as storage medium. And also they put some numbers about the efficiency, which is the efficiency of heat coming in and heat going out. And this can be very high, because in the end, the surface is rather low for such a large volume of molten salt. So this is also an advantage of thermal energy storage, that we can have a very high efficiencies, for example, compared to batteries. So I want to give you a brief overview of things we do at DLR, but I think this is more or less also the research lines in other research institutes in Europe and the US. So this should give an overview of the research in the thermal energy storage field. So we follow basically the value chain, starting from the material, looking at material aspects, looking at process technology aspects, looking at component on the component level, also on the thermal energy storage component, and then looking at the integration aspects of the storage. This is always a key, because two tank storage are easily to integrate, but other storage options are more complicated to integrate them into the system. Some research aspects about salt. So one general idea is that we want to widen the temperature range. The lower temperature range is limited by the freezing temperature. The upper temperature range is limited by the decomposition of the salt. And the basic idea is to widen this range. Typically, either it's that we want to reduce it or that we want to increase it. In most cases, we find that we cannot do both. So if we want to lower it, we can use ternary salts, for example, and measure phase diagrams and determine the minimum melting temperature of such systems, and replace typical systems with solar salt, which is a binary salt mixture, by ternary or quaternary mixtures. If you want to raise the temperature, we can do two things in our view. One is to look at the nitrate system. This is what also Rainer Buch in the morning showed. To increase the temperature here, we need to understand the decomposition mechanisms in a better way than we do it now. And the other way is to change the salt, for example, by chlorides to go to higher temperatures. Salts like to react with a lot of things. They like to react with gases. They like to react with metals, with maybe also other materials. So it's always an issue to look at corrosion, especially at a very high temperatures. And also what we want to do for our single tank concept, I introduce this later on, they react also, can react also with materials. So we want to examine this. thermal properties are important. And what we did in the last 2 years is to establish a proper post-analysis of our salts that we can determine the salt composition. Let me give an example about molten salt chemistry and what can happen in a real system. We have a two-tank system. We have the salt, which is composed of cations and anions. This is the melt, the salt melt. And we have an atmosphere, and there can be interactions between the atmosphere and the salt. So we can examine this by different methods. We can analyze the gas coming out of such a system. We can analyze the salt, and we may have a look at mass losses of the salt, and we can also do some modeling of such a system. At ELR, we have erected a molten salt plant for testing. So we can we have two tanks and supply salt inside a building and do some tests in a certain area, which is also safe. And we can do testing of components, because we find that especially at very high temperatures, at the 560 degrees, there's still a demand to do testing of valves or other measurement and control components. We also find that freezing is still an issue which needs to be solved and understood. And we can operate this with different salts in our facility. The facility is split in two parts. We have a second part, and in the second part, we examine a single tank. So the idea is to replace the two-tank system by a single tank, and we have hot salt at the top and cold salt at the bottom, and we have a thermocline zone in between, and we introduce some filler material in this tank. And the filler material replaces some of the salt, and by doing this, we can reduce costs. So our calculations show, and we published this also in the Solar Paces, and Sandia also did some calculations, that we can reduce the capex of the storage system significantly by about 20 to 40%. This is the range, and also there is LCOE reduction potential of this concept compared to the two-tank system. So we think this is a good way to go forward and to reduce costs. This is not only done by DLR, but there are also other groups following this approach. So this is the plant. We operate now since about half a year with molten salt, and there are still some issues to solve, and we are still in the commissioning phase. So I think to operate this at 560 degrees is still something which is possible, but there are a lot of small things to consider. So I conclude already. I showed some figures from the IEA. I think molten salt storage is an important part, and it can contribute to grid stabilization. I think at 560 degrees, we still need some better understanding on material, better understanding on components and reliability. There's no long-term experience in the end at this high temperature level. There is only long-term experience at 500 degrees. But we still need to do some work and reliability improvement at 560 degrees. And we think the thermocline filler concept is the major concept to reduce costs for the storage system. And with this, I thank you very much for your attention, and I'm open for questions.